we're continuing our discussion of well-designed and poorly designed websites. And we looked at some examples last time, and we talked about what we liked and what we didn't like. And my challenge for you folks for today was to find some really horrible websites, because they're fun to talk about. Yes?
I have one that I can see.
Okay, what is the name of it?
It's called Ling's Cars,
L-I-N-G-S. Every semester. Someone mentions this one. This is a classic. If they were to ever redo their site and make it good, I would be heartbroken. I really would. I wouldn't be able to deal with it. Ling's Cars. All right. And I'm saying this, and this is honestly not a joke. If you are prone to seizures, close your eyes for a second, or for a few seconds, and all that. And again, I'm not even joking here. We'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. Or actually, when we talk about accessibility. All right, here we go. Pretty amazing, right? I don't even know where to begin on this one, which should probably tell you what its biggest problems are. We can't even figure out where to start when we're making fun of it. Imagine if you were trying to actually find something on this website. The chicken is among my favorite things. This appears to be a legitimate website for a legitimate business. I mean, this isn't just like a joke or something, you know. This almost falls into the category like some movies from the 50s that are so bad that they're good, all right? But this is so bad that it's horrible, all right? Could you even begin to, if you were looking, apparently this is a car leasing service, is what I gather. Yeah, want a cheap new lease car? Start here. All right. Wow. So that part of it is lease is clear. But would you even know where to begin? Let's say you had a specific need in mind. Let's say you wanted to lease a larger sort of vehicle, like an SUV or something. Where would you even begin?
I'd see what the dog is looking at.
You'd see what the dog is looking at. You can't find a car? I'm almost afraid to click on that. Yeah, right, they're going to make it harder, right? It's going to be the same page, except the stuff's going to move around. Oh, well, see. Complete my easy, fun-to-use form. I might have to go in later to see how fun it is to use, because this doesn't really look that fun, but maybe there's something I'm missing here. All right, and obviously what's wrong about this site? I mean, we barely even need to comment on it. What's wrong with this site?
It's too many visual elements.
Too many visual elements, too much going on. We talked about white space last time. There is practically no white space going on. The use of colors. Colors are effective when they highlight something. If you remember, compare this to the Apple website, which is literally comparing apples to oranges. See what I did there? Because this is Apple's website. Where they use a splash of color here and here. Everything is monochromatic. Everything is black, white, and gray, except for a couple things that are a different color. Wow, those things stand out. All right? Compare that to Ling's Cars, where they have... Let me count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 30 million different colors. All right? Which means nothing stands out, really. All kidding aside, animations can trigger seizures. All right? And therefore, this could be problematic for someone that was suffering from that. So I won't leave it in the screen too much longer. All right? But it's just overkill. And sites. I will say there were more sites back in the old days like that. All right? Because people got the idea of websites that, like, well, just plain text is boring, and we want a immersive experience, and all this. All these were good intentions, but web developers were just having too darn much fun, right? Writing code like this is fun to write. It's a blast to make the chicken run around the screen. It really, really is. So I understand it. However, as a web developer, you're not writing code to amuse yourself. I mean, you can, but don't put it up on the web, on a real business website. You know, do it on your own time. So it may be fun. It may even be funny to look at, like for us, because we're not actually trying to lease a car. All right? However, if you were trying to lease a car, this would really, really be difficult to use because there's simply too much stuff, and there's nothing about the page that guides you in the path of where you want to go. If you get to Apple's page, to contrast, you're given some guidance. Here are the main things that you might be interested in, and so on. So your walkthrough, there's good navigation. Whereas, you know, Ling's Cars would be sort of be like having a library where all the books were just like in a giant pile on the floor. And you'd go into it and it's like, well, find the book you want. They're all over there, you know, where you, with no organization, no sense of separating one group of things from other groups of things, and so on. Anyone else have an example of a bad website? Yes.
Art.yale.
Another perennial.
It's safe.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'm going to put yale.edu, so I know I'm not going to go too far wrong with that. Let's drink this in for a minute. A little bit of animation. Probably not fast enough to trigger seizures, but I guess I'm not an expert in that area. So feel free to look away if you're concerned. What about this site?
Moving images in the background,
and what's wrong with that?
Distracting.
It's distracting, right? I honestly have not been able to look at anything else on the page except watching the donut turning into a coffee cup and back.
Why is it even there?
Giant motorcycle.
Why is it even there? Yeah, good point. It could be someone showcasing their skills, that they were able to write a little animation to do that, which could be valid on a art website, but not as a background of the page. You know, when we start getting further into this, you can see things like this. Well, the text is really sort of hard to read. I'm not even sure if you're supposed to read it. The colors are just
ugly.
And for an art site, it is weird. Now, this is Yale, so maybe they're just smarter than me. All right? I mean, that's always a possibility, right? But I don't know. I think this looks very amateurish, all right? And amateurish not in the right way, you know? It's funny. This is one of my pet peeves. Amateur is not a bad word, you know? It depends how you use it. Because an amateur is someone that literally does stuff because they love to do it, right? As opposed to a professional who does it only because they're getting paid, right? So if you say something's amateurish, I guess it depends on what you're talking about. Sometimes amateurish stuff is charming. Like if you go to a kid's Christmas concert or something like that. It's like, oh, that's cool. You know, you don't want to hear polished performers. You want to hear kids just singing their hearts out, you know, just because they love to do it. Whereas this is amateurish in the wrong way. Amateurish in that it distracts from the message of the site. Like I said, it's hard not to look at the donuts in a coffee cup, and that kind of obscures and diverts your attention from everything else on the page. Zeller's law of web development is everything on the page can distract from everything else on the page. So the fact that this is going on the page distracts from everything else on the page. Now, that might be okay, right? Or it might be a problem. If you're putting additional stuff on the page that's good, then that's okay. You know, going back to Apple site. Yes, these two things distract from each other, but there's only two of them, and both of them are valuable. Whereas on this page, there's some stuff on this page that clearly is distracting that isn't particularly valuable. Anyone else have another bad example? Yes?
I think coretechnology.com is pretty bad.
Core technology. One?
Yeah. I think it's pretty shoddy.
Seems like it's from the 90s or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would say if anything, I would say that this looks a little dated, maybe. And is that a big deal?
Guess not.
Well, I don't know. I'll tell you what. Almost any question I ask in this class, you can answer with "it depends," right? Because it depends if it's a problem, all right? Sometimes it wouldn't be a problem. Sometimes it would be a problem. What might make it a problem in this case?
Web developers won't like looking at it.
Well, yeah, and how is that particularly relevant here?
Not at all.
Well, no. No, I think it actually is a little bit relevant here.
If you were maybe trying to look for business, you'd see this and be like, well, they didn't put much work into it.
Okay, maybe.
Keeping it up to date.
What other thing might be a problem about this? And I don't know what this company does. I'm kind of looking at the... The fact that this is a technology company.
If you were a web developer and you were looking at careers, you'd be like, maybe.
Possibly. I guess the problem that I have is this is a technology company. If you are a technology company, using dated technology isn't a good sign. And even though they're not particularly in the business of web development, you know, they are in the business of technology. So you might argue that they should have sites that look pretty up-to-date and current as opposed to something that looks old. Now, again, might be a little different in this case because it is a technology. They don't deal with web development technology. They're in another end technology. But still, that's likely to give you a negative connotation if you go to a technology company and you look like this. I guess I would compare this with, if I visited this page, and I can't remember offhand particularly who, but I visited like authors' pages, you know, people that write novels and stuff, authors, that look kind of old-fashioned. And you know what? I'm not caring that much there, because they're authors. They're not a technology company, you know. And therefore, it's like, well, who cares if this author's website looks dated? That's not the kind of business that's not their area. So who cares if it doesn't look, you know, fresh and sparkly and brand new? Much like clothing, all right, the more that you follow web development trends, the sooner you're going to look out of date. Like back, so many years back, these sort of buttons were real, real popular. Well, guess what? When this website was published, it probably looked very current. Well, now it doesn't look quite so current, all right? Whereas if you stick by some well-chosen design principles, you know, you may never look terribly in fashion, but you're never going to look terribly out of fashion either. All right. Compare that with any of the well-designed websites that we talked about. You know, talk about Google. You know, this is virtually the design of Google since day one. Is it a cutting-edge visual site? No, but it's still well-designed, and it looks just as well-designed today as it did back in the old days. Another example of a bad website. Yes?
Try a 007
museum. 007
museum.
Using a bunch of tables. Oh, and by the way, we're not even halfway through.
I think the entire website is on this page.
You know what? Interesting you should say that. Let's hold that thought. The entire website being on one page. All right? Let's file that away. And my memory is notoriously going bad, so remind me if I forget about this. All right, what's wrong with this site?
It's not well organized.
Exactly. Organization is the key. How does this compare with Ling's Cars? They're both bad, all right, but I think they're bad in a different way.
Header's not even centered on the top of the page.
Okay. Header's not centered on the top of the page. Here's the interesting thing. I'll bet you it's centered on the screen of the web developer that developed this. And that's, again, a consideration. You know, don't make it work just on your machine, but make it work on everyone's machine. How is this wrong in a different way than Ling's Cars is wrong? Yeah, it's not distracting. Ling's Cars have so much going on that it was difficult to use because everything distracted from everything else. All right. What's wrong with this page? Heard not organized? What? Can you repeat what you said? Or whoever said it? I just heard a voice coming from over here.
That everything's on this page.
Pardon me? I still can't tell who's talking.
Not me.
Okay. All right. I was going to say, I assume it sounded to me like it was coming from the first two rows and no one's lips were moving. It's like, we must have a ventriloquist in here or something, you know, because that's amazing. But, I see. I think you're behind the fellow in the red shirt. There you go. You're right. That everything's here and there's no sense at all of organization. All right. It's just, in a different way, it's just like the pile of books in a library. It's like, it's not that they have overkill of too many visual things, it's that they haven't used anything to organize a page for the user. So it's one giant glob, undifferentiated blob of data that you just have to sift through if you want to, all right? And my thought is most people probably wouldn't spend a lot of time bothering with this page. You know, they would look at it, maybe spend a minute on it, and give up. Because I don't know what, you know, if the harsh reality is if people can't find something quickly on the website, they're liable to go on somewhere else. So this page doesn't use any of the visual elements in any way to organize the information on the page. Alright? Remember, that's why we use the visual elements. That's why we use things like color, things like borders, things like columns, things like white space. We don't use it just to make it look nice. We use it to make it look nice and make it easier to use. There's an old cliche, and I'm not sure, I think it came first from biology, but people have used it for other things, that form follows function. All right. I've heard that adapted to say form is function. And what that means is the way that you organize, the way that you structure material is going to have a giant impact on the way people use it, on the functionality of it. All right. And therefore, you need to spend some attention to the form of the page to help people use it. It's not simply enough to give people the pile of information and let them sift through it. All right. And anything that you do should help people find the stuff that they're looking for and not distract them from that. All right. So Lynn had one problem. They used a lot of visual elements, which, if they use them very carefully, might allow to focus on one or two particularly important things. But they don't use them carefully. They've thrown everything but the kitchen sink at that page. And I didn't scroll long enough. Maybe I would have found the kitchen sink in a couple more minutes, all right? But they put everything they could think of on that page. And therefore, if everything is emphasized, it's the same thing as nothing being emphasized, right? Whereas this page really doesn't do anything to structure the page. And as a result, again, you're left basically with the same problem. There's a lot of information on this page, but who knows how you find any of it. How many of you speak a language other than English? What language?
A little bit of Japanese.
A little bit of Japanese? Anyone else? Yes.
French.
French? I want to pick something that no one in the room speaks. That's why I asked. Let me see if I could quickly find an Icelandic news. I'll say news in Icelandic. Use handy dandy. Maybe. I'm going to go to advanced search. And I'll be looking for, there we go. Be looking for sites in Iceland. Why are these all in English? Here we go.
Do you speak Icelandic?
No.
Oh.
This is starting to irritate me. This isn't a bad website, but what can we tell from this website without speaking the language? That's what I was trying to get at.
There's some event on August 19th.
Yeah, there's some event on August 19th, all right? This is navigation, all right, based on its position. These things are grouped together. These things are grouped together. These things are grouped together. How do we know that? Do we know that because we can read the words and we know that this has something to do with this, and this has something to do with that. No, we know it because they're grouped together for us visually. All right? They chose a little background image to do that. And there's space between these. These don't all run together. If you could imagine doing this differently, if we got rid of the images and ran all this stuff together, would be like the James Bond page. We'd just have a blob of information that we didn't know what was what. However, this, the use of the visual language here, tells us some things even though we don't speak the language. We know that this is one thing and this is something else. And that this information is related to this information. This stuff is related to this. This is related to that. And so on down the line. We see these as three separate sections, simply by the way that they're organized in the columns. And they have headings that stand out. And the use of icons even gives us a further tip that this is probably their Instagram page, this is their Twitter feed, and this is their Facebook. So their use of icons, their use of grouping things together, and they're following web conventions of having a navigation on the top of the page. Let's click on one of these. Okay, well, we're out of luck here, but we can tell that there's some kind of search thing going on. We can see at a glance that this is the most important idea, because it's in the biggest, so that's the headline. This is a secondary headline, and these are paragraphs. These might very well be asides. We can see that this is related to, all this stuff is related together, all this stuff is related together, this is a separate unit, and all this is a separate unit. So, my point is even without knowing the language, simply by the way the page is organized, using all the things that we have learned and are going to continue to learn in CSS to organize the page, not just to make it look pretty. Now, this, I would say, this is a nice looking site. This is a pretty nice looking site. It's pretty plain, but the type is nice. It looks easy to read if I spoke the language and so on. And it seems like it's organized. We can get all those things about it simply by the visual language that they've used. Alright? So that's one of the things that we're going to focus on using all these design elements and visual elements for. Not merely making the page look nice. Certainly we want our page to look nice. But more importantly to that, than to guide the user through our site. And to help the user visually organize the content on the page. Absolutely nothing was done to help the user visually organize the information on the page. Is this related to that? I don't know. Maybe, maybe not. Is this related to that? Who knows what is connected to what? And we can read the language in this case. All right. The other one, we were able to make some observations about what was related to what, even though we didn't speak the language. And I will bet we're right as far as this belongs together with that and so on and so forth. All right. So that's an important part of design, and that's when I say that the design, the form of the page, leads to the functionality of the page. By organizing the page and using these design elements, we can create a page that's much more usable and help guide the user through the site. Are there any additional bad websites?
I thought I had one until I saw these. This one I had written down is not even bad no more.
Well, what is it? We can look at it.
It's Suzanne. It's SuzanneCollinsBooks.com.
pretty bland. It looks a little dated. I mean, kind of like the technology one is. This is a good example of what I would say in that...
Author.
It's an author.
Right.
Right. So I am a little more forgiving for an author having a web page that looks sort of dull than a technology
and
company.
And after you said that, I really didn't want
to
say
this. Right. No, no, that's fine. I would agree with your conclusions. I mean, they could do a lot more probably to organize and make it more visually appealing.
But after seeing the others, this actually looks kind of good.
I wouldn't go so far as say that looks good. It just doesn't look quite as bad. Now, here's the one thing I would say. This person looks like they are the ones that wrote the, is it Hunger Games books? Yeah. Who's the audience for the Hunger Games books? Who's the target audience for the Hunger Games books?
Teens.
Yeah, young adults. All right. Does this site look good for young adults? Probably not. So, in that regard, I would say that's one area where this missed the boat as well. All right. Now, one thing I mentioned before, and we'll go back to, is let's look at a couple of websites for, a website for, I'm thinking TV networks, cable networks. Let's look for Nickelodeon's website. Of course, I can't type, so that might take the rest of the class. Nickelodeon. It's been a while since I watched Nickelodeon because my kids are grown up now. I don't even know what's on it now. It's good to see that the classics are still there. These rest of these, I don't really know. What's another cable channel that maybe appeals to adults? Let's look at the Food Network. Let's just compare these two. What observations do you have when looking at these two websites?
Nickelodeon's more reliant on images.
Nickelodeon's more reliant on images?
Target audience is obvious.
True. Yeah, well, I was gonna argue that for a second, but you're absolutely right, because these are navigation links. Whereas on Food Network, they have text for the navigation. So text navigation versus image navigation. You said the target audience for Nickelodeon is?
Kids.
Very apparent.
All right. Whereas the target audience for Food Network is?
Adults.
Kind of everyone, yeah. Right? I mean, my kids love Food Network when they were younger, you know? So what things do you have, what things do you think these two sites share in common?
They have kind of a similar splash page.
They have a similar homepage, which is highly focused on images, all right? What else? Let's go and visit one of these pages. So let's visit the SpongeBob page. And let's visit Chant. Similar sort of content, right? They have video clips and so on.
For some reason, the ad on the SpongeBob page looks really out of place to me.
The what?
The ad on the SpongeBob page looks really out of place.
Oh, this?
Yeah. feels weird being centered from the...
Well, let's think about that. Do you think they did that on purpose?
Yeah.
Why do you think they did it on purpose?
Because you can see it.
So you can see it. So it doesn't get lost with all the other SpongeBob content.
The horizontal scrolling is a little annoying.
The horizontal scrolling is very annoying, especially when you use the track wheel to scroll down and it takes you from side to side. I do not like that. That may be a personal preference, but that's not intuitive to scroll up to go to the left. Unless I turn my mouse this way, and then it looks right. Do these sites look serious or do they look fun?
This one looks serious.
This one looks serious, really?
I guess it depends on how serious you get.
Yeah, I guess it depends on what you mean by serious. This looks more grown up, I would say. But this doesn't look serious as compared to, what would be something really serious that would be not controversial?
Hunting.
Pardon me?
A hunting website.
Hunting?
I guess.
I was thinking something like really scientific. Paper on... cosmology. Perfect. This is a Cornell University Library. This, in my mind, is a serious website. All right. This, you're right, is more adult-looking than this. But this still, I would say, has a not serious, a more fun, and maybe substitute the word entertainment for fun, all right? Because entertainment doesn't have to be fun the way that is. Yes?
Like a good comparison for that might be like, I don't know, because that's got a lot going on the Food Network, like you said, kind of fun or whatever. But if you just go to like Wolfgang Puck's website, you know, as a chef.
Okay. We'll pick him and not Gordon Ramsay, all right?
No, like the end songs.
Well, I was just being silly. I've only seen him a couple times, but yeah, he...
Yeah, I think this looks more serious, kind of. I mean, fun, but...
Right.
It looks nice.
It looks nice. And we can look, and that's something that I think is valuable to do. When you look at a site, consider who you think the audience is and what the tone of the website is. And does the tone match sort of what the audience's intent is in coming to it? You know, people coming to the Food Network are largely looking at being entertained. All right? Maybe they're interested in some recipes too. All right. I have watched the Food Network for I don't know how many years, and I could probably count on my hands the number of recipes I've actually made from watching those. All right. Now I've seen them make about a million recipes, and I've probably made 3 or 4. All right. So it's largely an entertainment as opposed to, I don't know, a site that may be more focused on the recipes and that. But this is meant to be an entertaining site. As is this. And the difference between the two is the audience of a more general audience versus an audience targeted towards kids. I did say real quickly I was going to look at one-page websites. one-page website. So you click down, it takes you down. There's navigation here. That takes you to the top. Oh, that takes you to another page. So they lied to me. Here's an about. That scrolls to the about. There's Instagram. Well, that also lied to me.
So if it takes you to an external web page, it's not considered a one-page website?
Well, I don't know. I guess that's a judgment area. It seems like most of this content is on the same page. But notice what they're doing here is they're using those internal anchors like we did in class, putting an ID of pound sign and giving it a name, and they're scrolling to that portion of the page. All right. So the statement that we looked at the James Bond site, you know, compare this to James Bond site, you know. The James Bond site, everything seemed to be on the one page, but it was just a giant heap. This, there's at least some organization in. All right? So you can do a good one-page website if you want. Or you can put a lot of content on one page, but still you want to give people guidance. All right, let's make some general observations now. We've looked at a bunch of specific cases and said what we liked and what we don't like about them. And again, there may be ones that you know of or that you think about that, like, oh, I hate when I have to order something from such and such company, or I tried to order something from such and such company, but it was too difficult, so I gave up, or whatever. What would you say makes a well-designed site versus a poorly designed site? What are some of the characteristics either of a well-designed site or a poorly designed site?
Organization.
So I assume that's a well-designed site.
Pleasant well, to look at.
Well-designed site is organized. What was the second thing that you said?
Pleasant to look at.
Pleasant to look at. Visually appealing. What else?
Accessibility,
and what do you mean by that?
It's tailored for multiple devices and it's visually impaired users.
Okay. And I'm going to extend that to say people with different disabilities as well, besides visual impairment. Yes.
Easy to navigate.
Good navigation. Course, I think goes hand in hand with that, right? It would be hard for a page to be easy to navigate if it was poorly organized, all right? And if a page had poor navigation, then another way to say it is it's not very well organized. Anything else?
Good content.
Good content.
Personalization.
Right. Personalization is a nice touch. Unfortunately, for our projects, we don't cover the technology to do much personalization. So this is going to sort of take a back seat in the examples we go over. But that's an excellent point. If you can personalize a site, that's great. Other things?
Consistency.
Which again leads to good navigation, good organization, and so on. Anything else?
Not too distracting.
Not too distracting. I will say, not distracting. No or minimal extra unimportant stuff. Anyone else? good list. A couple things I would add to it. Number one is readability. One thing I would say is the right amount of content. Not too little, not too much. Especially on one page. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. I think all these are really good things. Now again, notice for the most part, these are things that are going to help the user find the information that they are getting at. The one thing I like to say and like to point out is this is going to, these things are really good guidelines, but they're going to vary a lot depending on the specific website. All right? All websites should be visually appealing. That's true. You want your website to be visually appealing. But what does visually appealing mean? Well, it means who you are. You know, you got to take into account who your audience is. When I looked at Cornell University's library, all right, that was visually appealing. When I looked at Nickelodeon, that was visually appealing. Did it look the same? No. Could you imagine if Nickelodeon site was done like Cornell's library? It'd be boring for the kids to go to that site. Could you imagine if Cornell's library was done like Nickelodeon site? That wouldn't work either. So the thing to keep in mind is all of these things are filtered by the tone of the site. So, I can't make a rule that says, don't ever have a dancing chicken on your page. Because you know what? There may be a web page where a dancing chicken is the perfect thing to have on your page. All right? If you're a comedian's website or whatever. All right? So, therefore, you can't make, you know, carved in stone rules without taking into account the kind of site it is. I'm going to mention a keyword that we're going to continue as we talk about your project next week. And that is goals. Remember, the designers of the site, in other words, who makes the site, and who uses the site, both have goals. All right? Both have goals. A site is well designed if it helps these two groups of people achieve their goals. It's not well designed if it's hard for these two groups of people to achieve their goals. All right? And again, think of sites that you visit. Why do you visit certain sites? What is it that you're looking for? Is the site designed in a way that makes it easy for you to get what you want? Or is the site designed in a way that's hard for you to get what you want? That, in my mind, is key as far as whether a site is well designed or not. We want it to look nice, but more important than that, we want our users to be able to find what they're looking for easily, quickly, and accurately. So next week we'll talk a little bit more about goals, and then we'll talk about the project and the project design. Are there any questions now? All right, we'll see you in lab.